morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to chapel. Let's see what's going on this week. We have a whole host of people who have announcements for you. Woo! So today there is a student to faculty panel for just the education majors tomorrow, it says today, from 5:30 to 6:30 in the RCF. So it's for all the education majors. If you're an education major, you need to go. Zumba is tonight in PEC. Weekly prayer group is tomorrow from 9 to 10. Under the Lights is Friday at 7. Blue Gnu is meeting Dunkel Jim this Friday at 7. If you're a freshman, you need to go. I don't know why, but you do. I'm just kidding. Go. Here we go. Gainy Clue, it says that it's this Saturday, but it's actually next Saturday, April 5th at 7 p.m. Sign up outside the D.C. Swing dancing classes are from 7 to 10 in Polling Lobby on Sunday. And then also on Sundays from 8 to 9 is the Sign Language Worship Fellowship. And then if you're interested in working for OIR, the position applications are due on April 4th. You can pick those up in Student Development and Learning. And then the 7th Annual Women in Leadership Conference is Saturday, April 12th. You can register outside the DC. And then we have an announcement about tonight.
Holy sexuality. Tonight's a great night to talk about sex from a biblical perspective, okay? Sarah Young's coming. She's a licensed counselor from West Michigan. She also has specialized training in sex therapy. Good time to come, get your questions answered about all issues in sexuality. We have a panel as well from campus, Elise Woba, Angel Kono, and Ron Capico. So come out 9 o'clock in the White Auditorium. Thank you. Rachel Bogues.
Thank you. You guys are loud. Well, good morning, you guys. I'm excited to announce to you today your next year's student body president and vice president is Ben Frederick and Brittany Bellamy.
Good morning, Spring Arbor. We just wanted to say a couple things really quick. First of all, thank you to everyone who came out to vote. Everyone who was involved in our campaign, we really appreciate it. And then we also want to say thank you to Matt Nanny, Caleb and Whitney. They did awesome too. And then the other thing that's important to us, we want to keep hearing your ideas. So send us your ideas the rest of this year into next year. And we're really looking forward to serving you guys next year. So thank you so much.
This has nothing to do with the presidential election at all, but there's a new ministry going to happen during chapel. Jesus sent his disciples out to preach, heal, and exercise. So we are here to pray for anything, specifically healing. We've seen different kinds of healings of people getting out of wheelchairs, back pains, legs growing, and of the such, burns being removed. So we will be here on the right-hand side if you would like some prayer during chapel. Thank you.
If there's anything going on in your life that you just need special prayer for, healing, concerns, just meet those guys over there and they'd be glad to just gather around you and pray for you. And before we go to worship, I've invited Kaylee Heim to introduce our speaker this morning. It's her mom. Kaylee is a senior global studies major from Rockford, and she has the privilege of introducing.
Hey guys, so like my mom is speaking this morning, so that's pretty cool. I just want to tell you that my parents are the kind of people that like pray their guts out. So I know that ever since they've known they've been, my mom's going to speak this morning, that they've been praying about it and that they've been praying for you guys. So even though my mom doesn't know you guys, she cares about you and she wants you guys to know God more. So she's going to try and teach you more about how to know God this morning, and I hope you enjoy it.
Before Ben leads us in prayer, let's stand together. Lisa's going to come on down front. Let's gather around her for prayer. Anyone who wants to join the prayer guys over here, join them. Let's join our hearts together as Ben leads us.
Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity this morning to join with each other and worship you. We thank you for Lisa this morning, who's come to bring your word to us. Will you lay your words on her heart for us today, Lord? Soften our hearts so we're ready to hear your word. And then, Lord, we just pray as a community over each other for anyone who's burdened this morning, anyone who's sick this morning, whether it be stress or physical sickness, Lord, we just pray your healing over that, Lord. We know the power of community, and we know your power. And so, Jesus, will you be here? Will your presence be rich? We love you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you. I can't. Thank you for meeting us where we are this week and today. Touch our hearts. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Good morning, Spring Arbor University. Great to be with you this morning. Well, as we begin today, I have a question for you. How do you respond when life gets frustrating? Have you ever had days when you look like that or you feel like that? I sure do. And you know, frustration comes to us in all shapes and sizes, doesn't it? We got a call from our son this week, and he told us the company he went to work for just a year ago is now downsizing, and it's likely he's going to be out of a job in a few weeks. That's pretty frustrating. Sometimes, you know, frustration can come in the form of a major relational breakdown. Sometimes it's a health problem. Those are pretty big frustrations. But more often, doesn't frustration just come to us more in kind of daily, small, little ways, like technology issues, your computer goes on the fritz right before you have a big paper due, or you misplace your keys, or maybe somebody just says something that hurts and makes you feel disrespected or unloved. I know over spring break, my daughter Kaylee was driving in about 10 o'clock at night in Kalamazoo, and she happened to find the biggest pothole in Michigan with her car and had a double blowout. I think she was pretty frustrated that day. Well, Mama said there'll be days like this. Did Mama say that? Well, guess what? Somebody else said it first. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. If you don't have it today, you will have it tomorrow. So where does all this frustration come from that we live in and day out? Are we just being attacked by the enemy? It sure can feel that way sometimes, can't it? And no doubt, he really does have his purposes behind frustration in our lives. He wants to use it to further his purposes in our lives and the lives of other people. But to really understand where frustration comes from, we have to go back to the scripture. And here's what it tells us. Romans chapter 8 says, "For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it." Now, who is the one that this is talking about? Well, scholars say that this is a reference back to Genesis chapter 3. When Adam and Eve disobeyed God, and God's response was to step in and bring consequences. And at that time, he said, there's going to be frustration in your lives. You're going to have frustration in relationships. You're going to have frustration in work. There's going to be thorns and thistles. And that frustration has extended to all of creation. Everything, everyone, you and me, and everything around us. Well, you know, when good things happen, don't we usually say, God showed up. Look how he provided. God showed up. And that's a good thing. We should say that. But how often do we recognize when something frustrating happens in our lives that maybe God is showing up in our lives? You rarely hear someone say, I had a flat tire. God showed up. I lost my job. God showed up. Praise the Lord. No, we don't talk that way. That sounds almost blasphemous to us, doesn't it? But maybe it's really true. Maybe God is showing up in ways we don't expect in our lives when we experience frustration. Well, if that is true, then it kind of begs this question. Why would a good and loving God frustrate his children? I mean, that doesn't seem very nice, does it? It doesn't seem very loving to frustrate us. You know, obviously I'm a parent. My daughter introduced me, and I also have a son And I know over the years, I have frustrated my children. My daughter could probably stand up here and give testimony to that fact that I have frustrated her many times. Well, we don't have time for that today. But how many of you have ever been frustrated by your parents? Right, well, probably every hand ought to be up in this auditorium if you're really being honest. It's in the job description of us as parents. You know, it's when you have that baby and you're leaving the hospital, they hand you this big job description. And right under food, feed, clothe, and house, it says, frustrate the snot out of this being for the rest of their life. That's what we're called to do as parents. Well, I remember a time that I frustrated my daughter, Kaylee. Situation that this is how it's become affectionately known in our home as the mashed potato incident. And Kaylee was only about maybe 6 or 7 years old. And we were, as a family, were sitting down to dinner one night. And one of the dishes I had prepared for the family that evening was mashed potatoes. Now, Kaylee decided, she is the youngest and smallest member of our family. But for some reason, she decided to help herself to about 90% of the mashed potatoes that were available that evening, leaving very little for the rest of us. And I kept saying to her, Kaylee, you cannot eat all those mashed potatoes. Yes, I can, Mom. I know I can eat them. Kaylee, you cannot eat those mashed potatoes. Don't take that much. Yes, I can eat it. I can eat it. Kaylee, you know, if you're going to take all those mashed potatoes, you're not going to get anything else until you eat those mashed potatoes. Well, sure enough, the end of the meal came, and she had not eaten all the mashed potatoes. She probably had eaten only a third of them. So she went off to play, and I just took her plate and covered it and put it in the refrigerator because I was going to win this one. I don't win them all, but I was going to win this one. Well, next morning she comes down for breakfast. I pull that plate out of the refrigerator and set those cold, lumpy mashed potatoes in front of her. It's like, Mom, what's this? I told you, you're not going to get anything else till you eat those mashed potatoes. So she ate a few more bites, decided she didn't want any more. She went off. Well, she came home for lunch that day. I pulled the plate out of the refrigerator. Those cold, now kind of gray mashed potatoes were there for her. And I set them down. I said, honey, you're not getting anything else until you eat these mashed potatoes. So I left the room. Pretty soon I come back, and there she is. Gagging down the mashed potatoes. I'm sorry, honey, you're going to have to send the therapy bills to me. My husband and I have often said it's not if our kids are going to need therapy as a result of our parenting, it's just when and how much. We're trying to minimize the bill a little bit. So, you know, sometimes as parents we frustrate our kids just because we're sinful human beings, broken just like you. But sometimes we frustrate them because we're trying to help. We're trying to help produce something good in our children's lives. But here's what we know about God. It says, our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good that we may share in his holiness. So nobody ever really needs therapy as a result of God's parenting in their life. Now, we might need help to understand it and submit to it, but we don't need therapy for it. Well, what is God up to in our lives? He wants us to share in his holiness. And one thing I know about frustration is that it can expose some very unholy things in our lives. One of the things it can expose is what we really believe. You know, sometimes we can believe lies that we don't even know we really believe. We think we're believing the truth, but when frustration comes along, it might expose that we're really believing something we didn't know we believed. it can also expose who we really serve. We might think we're serving God, but frustration, when it comes along, might show us that we're really serving someone other than the one true God in our lives. You know, it's really possible to be a Christian for many years. It's possible to be involved in a lot of ministry, to go to a great Christian college, to even be a speaker on the platform talking to people about God, but have some other idol in our lives that needs to be exposed so we can get rid of that. Well, how we respond when frustration comes our way, and there you have it, that's the choice we have. And how we respond, which direction we go, really tells us a lot about where we are with God. In fact, sometimes I think we don't really know for sure where we are with God until frustration comes along in our lives to tell us. We have the choice of either moving toward Him and believing truth and serving Him when we experience frustration, or we have that choice to, we call that going north when we go toward God, but we call it also going south when we have the choice to move away from God and to believe lies and to worship false gods in our lives. Well, my job as a Christian counselor, and I've been in practice for almost 30 years, helping people with frustration in their lives. And I really see my goal in helping people is not just to take away whatever it is or fix whatever it is that's frustrating them, but to truly help them respond to whatever's happening in their lives in a way that reflects going north, moving toward God, believing the truth, and responding to their situation in a way that reflects their love for God and their love for other people. Well, you know, when we go south in our lives, and we often can be guilty of that when frustration comes, we become something rather unholy. I call that being a grumbling grasper when we go south. And grumbling graspers believe lies. And here's a big lie that we believe when we become grumbling graspers and when we go south. The lie is that something other than God Himself and what He's chosen to provide for me right now will really satisfy my deepest needs. Something other than God and what He has chosen to provide for me. And you know what? That is exactly the same lie that Satan told to Adam and Eve in the garden. God said, "Of all these trees, you may freely eat, but that one over there, that one's out of bounds." No. And Satan comes along and says, "That's the one thing you got to have." He made them feel frustrated with what they had and determined to have what God had said no to in their lives. Well, we can fall into believing that same lie. So next time you feel frustrated, maybe it'd be good just to ask yourself, what is it that I think I need to have right now that God is not providing for me? And that something, whatever that something is in our lives, can become an idol. Here's just a sample of some of the idols that that we can actually be serving and not know it in our lives. One, the approval of people, what they think of us, achievement or success, work and productivity, just getting things done. Money is a big one. How about comfort or material possessions, thinking that our lives have to be at a certain level of comfort, or independence, freedom. I don't want anyone telling me what to do and when to do it. I want to be completely free to decide for myself what I want to do and when I want to do it. And then social cause that we can get involved with can also become an idol. And then there's the ever-popular relationship, that one certain person in our life that is the what we really believe is the source of what we most need. Well, there are certainly thousands more idols. And you know what? When we have an idol in our lives, God will love us enough to step in and frustrate that. He will not let our idol worshiping work. He will not let us go on believing lies because he loves us so much. Well, how do we know if we are going south and becoming a grumbling grasper, someone who's believing lies and maybe worshiping idols somewhere in my life? Well, one of the ways we can tell is by our emotions. You see, grumbling graspers experience a lot of destructive emotions in their lives, and that's something that we need to tune into and pay attention to. For example, we feel often anger or bitterness, worry, anxiety, jealousy, envy, shame, worthlessness, or self-pity. You know, I think that these emotions can serve us like signals, you know, like lights on the dashboard of your car. When you find yourself feeling these kinds of emotions, it's time to tune in and to look inside and to say, what lies might I be believing? What idols might I be serving that I need to take a look at? Well, not only can we tune into our emotions, but we need to tune into our behavior, because lies and idols will affect our behavior as well. Some of the ways that grumbling graspers can engage in self-serving behavior is, one, we can power up. That means we can use anger and pressure to get people to come through for us and to do what we feel like we need to have done so that we can be happy. Or we can just go passive, withdraw, avoid things in our lives, avoid responsibility, never take any risks. Or we can punish people. We can say, hey, you make me feel bad, I'm going to make you feel bad. Or we can try to please, we can perform and try to please people. I want to try to make you feel impressed with me, with what I can do or what I have or what I look like. Or I want to come through for you and I'm going to try to make everybody happy so everyone will like me. Or we can become a perfectionist. And perfectionists set up really impossible standards for themselves and often for other people in their lives because they believe they need things to be perfect if they're going to be happy. And if all else fails, we can go to pleasures. That means I'm going to pursue something that just makes me feel good, whether that's alcohol or drugs or food or video games or pornography. This is where a lot of addictions come into our lives, where we can use pleasure as a way of trying to make ourselves feel better in the frustration of life. Well, grumbling graspers are all about one thing, and that is control. They don't really want to depend on God and what he decides is best for them in the moment. They want to live by their own ideas. They want to be in charge of their own life. And let me tell you, I have been a grumbling grasper at times in my life, many times, in fact. But one particular time I remember was when I was in my mid-20s. I was right out of grad school, and I was in a work situation. And I had a lot of lies and idols that I believed that I didn't really know about at the time. And God put me in this work situation, and one of my idols was the approval of people. I wanted the love and acceptance of approval of people, and I thought the way to get that was through my performance. By doing things right, by working hard enough, I would get that. Well, God put me in this situation, and he frustrated that. He did not let me get the approval of people. In fact, he gave me a lot of the opposite. He gave me a lot of criticism. I experienced rejection. And you know what? It was really painful. And I was really angry. And I was angry with God. And I was angry with myself. And I felt a lot of shame. And I felt really worthless. But you know what? It was a severe, severe mercy in my life, because through that time, something I wouldn't ever choose to go through, and I wouldn't want to choose it again or wish it on anybody, but God used that, and through the Holy Spirit, through some wise friends and counsel I had at that time in my life, I really began to see my lies and my idols, and I really had an opportunity to repent of those things in my life. You see, what grumbling graspers need most is amazing grace. See, when I started to see how I'm really believing lies and I'm really pursuing the idol of approval of people in my life, I got to admit that I am sinning against God. I am saying, God, you're not enough. You and what you provide for me is not enough. I got to have something else. I got to take control. I got to do it my way. That is sin. And in light of my sin, what I really deserved is not to get my way, but to get judged by God. Now, God is absolutely gracious, and he doesn't give me that. Instead, he offers me forgiveness and help to become something better in my life. Well, grace really transforms grumbling graspers into grateful givers. Now, I'm not saying this is easy and simple. It happens overnight. It's often a process, and sometimes a painful process, and usually a lifelong process to some degree. But God is really patient, and he will help us as we humble ourselves. 1 Peter 5:5, James 4:6 says, God opposes the proud. He frustrates the proud, but gives grace to the humble. When we, in the middle of our frustration, choose to humble ourselves and not just focus on our frustration, but take a look inside at the lies and the idols that might be there that God is trying to get us to see about ourselves. And when we humble ourselves and admit that, God, I see those lies. I see there's an idol. There's something before you. God, I'm not trusting you. I'm trying to take control. When we admit that, God's grace is right there to help us, to open the door, to help us move to something better in our lives. One of the things our pastor says back home is that your greatest day of your life is the day you face yourself. And I've been fortunate to have many of those days in my life. I've needed many of those days. But I really believe that's true, that when we humble ourselves before God, he will open the door wide with his grace to help us change and to grow. Well, grateful givers become grateful givers partly because they choose to become grateful people. You know, when you're a grumbling grasper, you're not very grateful. You're only focused on what's wrong or what you don't have instead of what's right. And we need to really begin to practice gratitude for the many good gifts that God gives us day in and day out. Just the way down here, I was thinking about this and just noticing even though it's, still the middle of winter in March, in Michigan, I was noticing just the beauty of nature as I was driving along and being grateful for that, and grateful that I have a car to drive to get here, and grateful that my daughter goes to a great university like Spring Arbor where I can come and share with you, and just so grateful for the many good gifts that God gives me every day all around us that we often miss. But you know what? Even if I lose all those gifts, God has other gifts for me that I can never lose. I call those his gracious gifts. And those are the gifts of his promises. Here's just a few of them. The Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving toward all he has made. I can count on God's faithfulness and his love. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He is going to meet all of my needs. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. I'm not alone, no matter what. If everyone on earth rejects me, God is still with me. He's still for me. And we know that all things, in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. No matter what happens in my life, God is up to something good. He's going to bring good out of it as I trust him with that. Christian author Ann Voskamp put it this way. She said, gratitude isn't only a celebration when good things happen. It's a declaration that God is good no matter what happens. And I believe that is true. We sang that this morning. God is good all the time. We know as we practice being grateful people in our lives, we really can start to feel more positive emotions in our lives. Emotions like peace and joy and contentment grow in our lives. Rest, happiness really can be more of our regular daily experience as we turn to God in the truth, believing that truth and being grateful for it in our lives. And not only are we grateful, but grateful givers, they serve God by thinking of the needs of others. You know, when you're a grumbling grasper, you're just frustrated with what you're not getting in your life, you don't really think about anybody else. You don't think about what they need or what they would long for, or maybe what frustrations other people around you are feeling. You only think about what you want. But when you become a grateful giver, one, you can begin forgiving others who are frustrating you. That's a place to start, because other people can be very frustrating. Secondly, we can speak the truth in love. We can respond to whatever frustrating situation we are experiencing with truth and love, because people need both from us. And thirdly, we can begin to give our time, our talent, and our treasure as we think about other people and serving them well. Well, in response to what they have been given, grateful givers serve God by loving and serving people. So our lives come more and more in line with obedience to the greatest command, which is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and your neighbor as yourself. That's something a grumbling grasper will never do. Well, just as grumbling graspers are all focused on control, grateful givers are all about one thing, and that is trust. Trust in the goodness and the greatness of God. And they're going to go deeper with God, no matter what kind of frustration comes into their lives. You might recognize this lady. Her name is Johnny Erickson Tada. She is one of my heroes in the faith. If you don't know her story, when she was 17 years old, she took a dive off a raft into the Chesapeake Bay and broke her neck. And she has been a quadriplegic, paralyzed from the shoulders down for 47 years. She's been in that wheelchair. Now, there's a lady that's had a lot of frustration in her life, wouldn't you say? I mean, most of the things that you and I take for granted daily, she cannot do. She can't brush her own teeth, comb her own hair. She can't go for a walk. So many things she can't do. And God did not remove her frustration. Now, I know she prayed for that. She prayed for healing. And you know, when we get frustrated, it's okay to pray and ask God to take away whatever it is that's frustrating us. We should do that. But sometimes he just doesn't do it. And then what happens? Where are we then? Will we become a grumbling grasper? Feeling justified in being angry and bitter and self-centered? Or will we become a grateful giver? Well, let me tell you, Johnny is one of my heroes because she has chosen in her frustration to become a grateful giver. And I love this quote for her in as she's referring to the fact that she hasn't been healed physically. She says, God's plans for me go far deeper, a deeper healing, a precious healing of the soul. You know, I like that so much because I think that's what God cares more about than all of us, in all of us as well. He wants a deeper healing, a precious healing of the soul in our lives. And I believe that is why at times he really allows us to be frustrated. Well, I have a lot of other heroes in my life. Most of them are just very ordinary human beings, people that I have worked with in counseling and good friends that I know, people in my church, my husband. They're also people who, when they face the daily battle in their lives, when they face frustration, that daily battle to go north, to choose God, to be a grateful giver rather than a grumbling grasper, I really respect those people. I look up to them. I hope you have heroes in your life who are similar, people that you look up to. Well, just in conclusion today, I want to challenge you. When life gets frustrating, will you respond as a grateful giver? That certainly would be my prayer for you. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father God, just thank you so much for these dear men and women, Spring Arbor University, their love for you. Father, like all of us, I know that they experience frustration in their lives. And so, Lord, I just pray that by your grace that you would help them when they face that to be aware that you're up to something and you're up to something good and that you want to set them free from lies and idols so that they can be a grateful giver, someone who brings you honor and glory through their lives. So, Father, as we go from here today, we just pray that your Spirit would be upon all of us and help us to make that choice daily. We pray it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.